Oh, Lair, if we're going to outrun these police, we better hide out in this warehouse here. Let's get inside.
Good idea. Good idea.
Oh.
Now, why is it so dark in here? I can't even see my own fingers.
Well, hold on. Let me just find the light switch here. Oh, here it is.
Hank, this is a broom closet.
Oh, whoops. Sorry about that. Well, let me just find the door. Uh-oh. This thing must lock from the outside. Looks like we're stuck until the custodian comes around.
Goodness, Hank. This makes Alcatraz look like the Ritz Hotel. I can barely move in here.
Oh, really? Well, then I'm sorry I belittled you, Larry.
What was that now?
I've really got us in a tight spot this time, I guess. Oh, I sure feel small.
Oh, well, it's unusually humble of you, Hank. Hey, what are you giggling about?
I don't mean to minimize our situation here, but...
Oh, no, not again. Don't you start this.
Oh, Larry, let me just give you a little advice.
So help me, Hank. I am armed with a dustpan, and I don't want to use it.
Now, come on, don't be short with me, Hank. I'm just trying to make some small talk.
There is something wrong with your mind, Hank.
Oh, Larry, you sound just like my shrink. But I guess that's one of your many strengths.
This is Special Collections, radio tours to museums, attractions, and other interesting places that capture the imagination and have unique stories to tell. I'm your host, Jeff Simpson, inviting you to join us as we explore the world through its special collections. Today on Special Collections, we're going to do something a little different. You've often heard the argument regarding whether size matters. Well, over the course of our show, we're going to prove that size does, in fact, matter, especially when it comes to small collections. Coming up, we'll be highlighting a museum from a small city, and a small candy company. But first, a big museum with a small collection. Have you ever wanted to travel back in time? Well, the Thorne Miniature Rooms in the Chicago Institute of Art are beautiful examples of painstaking craftsmanship, architecture, and interior decoration from historic places and periods. A handmade antique time machine, if you will. Today on Special Collections, we have Lindsay Morgan, who is, we're calling her, the keeper of the Thorne Rooms at the Chicago Institute of Art, to talk about one of the most popular exhibits in that renowned museum. Lindsay, welcome to Special Collections.
Hello, thank you for having me.
So, what are the Thorne Miniature Rooms? I'm intrigued.
So, the Thorne Rooms, first and foremost, are the creation of Mrs. James Ward Thorne, or Narcissa Thorne. She was a Chicago grand dame, as we like to call them. She was a woman who started creating the rooms in the 1930s. The thing to note is that this is an era where we have we're just post World War I. All of a sudden, grand estates from Europe are kind of opening up for the first time. It's right on the heels of people really starting to travel and do what was known as the Grand Tour. Things like Pompeii had been discovered, and then influences from that type of architecture had already influenced British and other European designs. And so this is kind of on the heels of when Mrs. Thorne started creating the rooms. So she was able to go to Europe and America and visit homes. The idea of visiting house museums started to come into play, as well as museums collecting full suites of furniture and all the decorations. So
yeah,
those were known as period rooms. And even here at the Art Institute of Chicago, we had a few full-size period rooms back in the day, and it was quite the popular thing at that point. So this was kind of the influence that Mrs. Thorne was under. But then there was another influence, and that was collecting miniatures.
Mm-hmm.
She had a predecessor in this who was obviously quite famous, which was Queen Mary of England, who was an avid collector of miniatures. And, of course, if a queen is doing something, it is quite a popular thing for young ladies and women who have extra means to endeavor in as well.
So, sure.
Mrs. Thorne was collecting miniatures and had the idea of putting together whole suites of rooms. There's a few different stories of how that came to be. Of course, seeing full-scale period rooms would have influenced her a lot. But then she was also requested to make playhouses for children. She was a benefactor of the Children's Hospital. So she put together some playhouses, and so kind of this combination of coming up with, a open-sided room for children to play with and the idea of period rooms. They're very theatrical. I think you can't get away from them being influenced by the stage. You have this three-sided room that you're viewing into.
Yeah.
So all this came together to make these really ambitious rooms. She first made a series of 12 rooms that were on view for the 1933-34 World's Fair, and that tumbled into a few more rooms for the 34 half of the fair. And after that, they were a huge success at the fair. But she decided she wanted to be even more exact, and
oh my goodness.
She started commissioning work, because this was the first set of rooms. There was a lot of objects that were objects that she had collected. But the second set of rooms, she started hiring craftspeople who are specialists in everything from a German carver. To quite a few architects were involved and engineers, and it was quite a real full production.
Sounds like a huge, huge undertaking. I'm just curious to know how long it took them to make these rooms and how much it cost.
We have a few pay stubs from one of her employees, and we know, like, one individual furniture piece she was paying a few hundred dollars for. And you have to keep in mind, this was during the Depression. So a few hundred dollars during the Depression, you can kind of extrapolate from there. But she didn't keep track, per se, of every single purchase. And then when the individual objects become part of a whole, which is the scene of a whole room, then it becomes kind of its own art piece altogether. So we at the museum treat the whole room as one piece of art. So we keep it just as she wanted it. The only time we kind of switch things up a little bit is it's quite a tradition in house museums as well as period rooms to do holiday events where you kind of take on the historical festivities and add more to the story of what would have been going on during those time periods.
Do you have any stories of her trying to create these rooms and some of the failures that she experienced? Because I imagine there would be failures dealing with these pieces that are so tiny. It would be so frustrating.
The one thing that she realized was not successful in the first set of rooms is she put a couple of figures within those rooms. And she realized by putting a figure in the room, people didn't imagine themselves within the rooms once there was a figure within that room. So she kind of deemed that a little bit of a failure. She decided she would never put a figure in the room again.
It's so interesting because when you were talking about that, it made me think of her, of Narcissa, as a sort of storyteller with this art. And she wanted people to insert themselves into their own little story that they make up in their minds.
Oh, and it's very, it elicits a lot of imagination in people. Anytime I'm out in the gallery space, I hear people over and over imagining themselves within the rooms and what they might do. And there's actually a children's book series that the writer, Marianne Malone, was inspired by our rooms, and she imagined the story of two young Chicago school children shrinking down and having adventures within the rooms. So it completely seems to be something that people find themselves doing. They really tell, lead you on these adventurous stories of imagining yourself in different time periods.
Narcissa sounds like an amazing woman. What was she like in later years? Did she continue to do these as she got older? She did.
But not to this scale. A thing of note is she spent an immense amount of money making these rooms, but she always used them for charity purposes. So many of the times that they were shown, whether it was at another museum or they went to a few world's fairs as well, there would be a little fee to enter the room enter the gallery space to see the rooms. And that money was always going to either the children's hospital or a program that she helped start that was called the Women's Exchange, which was kind of an auction that then trained women in usually a handicraft to help basically be the breadwinners for the family if they found themselves being the head of a household, whether they lost a husband during the war or whatever their needs were. This organization helped raise funds for women and train them in usually a handicraft of some sort, whether it be hat making or they'd make lampshades and various things. But Mrs. Thorne would donate these more shadow box, a lot smaller and less grand rooms, but she would donate these rooms that people could put in their own homes. So that was a huge project that she continued basically until she passed away.
So it sounds like the woman who made tiny homes had a huge heart.
She was, yes, she definitely did, but she was also very formidable. She was, and I don't think you can accomplish this large of a project without being quite a force to reckon with.
Yeah.
She knew what she wanted, was very generous to anybody who worked with her, but also expected, hard work out of herself as well as others.
If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Lindsay Morgan, who is the keeper of the Thorne Miniature Rooms in the Chicago Institute of Art. Lindsay, if you would please take us on a miniature tour of the miniatures.
It's a really fun little gallery, kind of shaped like a horseshoe, and people can go through first the European rooms, and then they loop around again and can view all the American rooms. And so it's quite an expansive set of rooms. It starts in like an early Gothic church on to the newest design style being like a 1930s, very modern. There's a London modern room, a San Francisco modern room, and a Paris modern room.
So, Lindsay, just how small are these miniature rooms?
So this scale, which she kind of standardized, is 1 inch to 1 foot.
Mm.
So it's a pretty easy equation. So you can imagine a chair, easily fits in the palm of my hand.
Yeah.
The scale is basically the smallest you can get with still retaining a lot of detail. It's still amazingly small with all the detail that is included, but it's a great way to be able to view an entire space all at once.
What is it you think your guests love the most about the miniatures?
They're very welcoming. I think often when you go in a house museum or in a period room that's full scale, it's very impressive, it's very beautiful, but you feel like, don't touch, I can't touch, I can't, like this isn't, you know, like, it's like almost like going into grandma's dining room, like my grandma would never let me sit on the couch in her like fine reception room like that.
Yeah.
That was just for looks almost. And this, even though you're not touching the pieces within the miniature rooms, you are very welcome. Like the invitation is there to imagine yourself.
Sure.
With interacting within the space. And they're very welcoming in that way.
So I imagine that, you know, clearly you said people can't just go up and touch these. But I imagine that these rooms and the furniture in them would still need to have repairs from time to time. How does the museum maintain all of this?
So they're as airtight as we can make them. Of course, I said they're made back in the 30s. So
yeah.
They originally used incandescent bulbs, and so those had to have heat escape. So the backs, they're basically, there's the main body of a room, and then attached to the sides of the rooms are the backdrops, and that's the light source for all the rooms. So there's little side rooms. They're very, and this, I think one of the things that's very impressive about these rooms is it's not just a room box. There's also, you look out the window and you see landscapes, you see other rooms. So they're really expansive, and they're all to scale in that way. So the little bit of, we have really great air filtration here now at the museum, but still we have people coming right off Michigan Avenue here in Chicago, one of the, you know, busiest streets there is, come right downstairs as they enter the museum. You're going to be bringing in a little bit of dust. So we filter the air pretty thoroughly, but we still definitely get a little bit of dust within the rooms. The rooms are dusted on a rotation, on average, every 4 to 6 months. Some rooms a little sooner, some probably only once a year, but on average between 4 to 6 months.
Wow.
Then in that rotation of dusting, that's when we inspect. As I said, everything's freestanding, so everything comes out of the room. As we clean the floors and deal with any shelves or whatever, then we look at the individual objects as we're putting them back in, and then we deem whether or not anything needs to happen to that object. Just recently, this last summer, I worked on a project. There was an old clock that had a finial missing, and I do make it a practice to work on my own miniature craft to be able to do repairs. So studied with a group called the International Guild of Miniature Artisans. There's a wonderful contemporary miniature artist named William Robertson who was teaching a class in making brass candlesticks. And it was all about being able to work on a lathe, doing miniatures with metal, and kind of trying to repeat the same pattern over and over again to be able to get identical pieces. And as while I was doing that, I had brought along the finial that needed replicating for the other side of the clock, and was able to duplicate that finial. And it's a whole effort of making sure everything looks great and sparkly, but it's pretty fun.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, talking about your own efforts in creating these miniature rooms, what is it that you think is so appealing about making miniatures?
I think that people just have that drive. I think it's just kind of innate in people. Since basically people have picked up tools, they've wanted to recreate their world and what they see in a scale that they can hold on to. We find examples from ancient Egypt in tombs. We, you know, find examples, tons of examples in Asia. There's a huge culture of making dolls that are representative of their ancestors, and then they give gifts to their ancestors. It's really seems to be a universal drive to make things in a small, compact way that you can really hold on to and be kind of like a way to be able to study and be masterful over something. It's like I'm here's this thing that I can hold and I can understand it more in that way.
Well, it sounds fascinating, and like we alluded to at the beginning, it sounds like the Chicago Institute of Art has found a way to take you back in time and to get a glimpse of what life was like just from these little miniature homes. And now, if only if you could shrink us down to size, that would really help.
It would help me with cleaning, too. Find a way, I'll manage it.
Wow. Well, her name is Lindsay Morgan, and she is the keeper of the Thorne Rooms in the Chicago Institute of Art. And Lindsay, we just want to thank you so much for your time again on Special Collections.
Thank you.
If your hometown had a museum, what would you put into it? Would you talk about your city's history, culture, or industry? Well, the city of High Point in North Carolina did all three and more, and now anyone from anywhere can come and learn about them. Today we have Teresa Laughlin, the Community Relations Director of the High Point Museum, to talk to us more about the city of High Point and their unique collection of furniture, from the large to the very small. Teresa, welcome to Special Collections.
Thank you for having me.
So first off, I want to talk about how the city of High Point got its name.
Well, that is a very unique story. We are actually the highest point along the railroad at the time, and so they marked a stake, and here we are. That became our name. We were the highest point. So High Point, that's how we got it.
That's perfect. Can you imagine if every other city in the country was named by just describing its geographical location?
It's descriptive, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're going to remember that because it is so simple, but it represented it so much to the community at that time.
Right. Now, this is something that a lot of people probably are not familiar with, but apparently the city of High Point has been referred to as the furniture capital of the world. What can you tell us about that?
Yes, well, we, back in the big booming business of furniture back in the day, we had tons of manufacturing furniture here in High Point. We still do today, but not quite on the same level. But twice a year, we have the High Point Furniture Market comes to town, which is the largest trade show for furniture buyers, and they come here, and we just wrapped it up a couple of weeks ago, and they come here and they see the new furniture and new styles. So that's kind of where we get it from. We have a lot of designers, furniture designers, designers of upholstery. We've got interior designers. We've got photographers. We have everything that you ever need to make your home complete here in the town, in our city.
All right. So talk to us a little bit about the museum. Now, what can visitors experience, or what do they first see when they show up to the museum?
Well, the first thing you're going to see when you get in our parking lot is you're going to see that we have four historic buildings on site, and you're going to want to go in those and explore those. But then once you come in the museum, you're going to be welcomed to everything there is to know about High Point's history. We start at the beginning and kind of in our core gallery, we trace it up until present day. And then we've got a couple of changing exhibit spaces. And then downstairs, of course, we have an exhibit on our furniture industry.
Now, Teresa, what are some of the interesting stories that your museum presents to visitors that highlight the area's home furnishing history?
Well, what we do is we started off talking about this industry. When you go in, it's like you're entering a furniture factory, so you can kind of feel and get the sense of what it was like to actually work in a factory. And so we have videos throughout the exhibit that show what it was like to actually be in one, and also talking to people that were actually working in those industries and in those factories. We talk about the families that built them, because at that time when furniture manufacturing started here in our community, it was a family. They would have baseball teams, and they would have picnics, and they would care for each other and all of this stuff. And so we talk about how the families built our city. And then we go on and we talk about the actual equipment. And so we have a multi-spindle carver. It's a gigantic piece of equipment, but on it you can actually make the spindles and legs and different things like that, but I think it's up to 12 at a time. And so this is something that, you know, that was the really heyday of the furniture industry in our community, is using these great pieces. And then you go over and you talk about the other industries that are in town because of the furniture manufacturer, such as photography, because you had to photograph all of that wonderful furniture to put in the catalogs so that people would actually purchase your items. And then we talk about the veneer and the paint companies and the interior designers and everything else, how it all came together to make what is known as the home furnishing industry.
Interesting. So what would you say are some of the more fascinating or interesting pieces of furniture that you have before we get to the miniatures? Because we did tease that, and we do want to talk about that here in a minute.
Yes, definitely. We have one of the earlier pieces of Marsh furniture cabinet, one of the early kitchen cabinets that they made. That's always interesting to see. And then we also have one chair down there that is like, it's in two parts. You see part of it where it's completely finished, and then the other side, it shows you how it's all put together. And so you can see the inside of it and how it's actually manufactured and how everything goes together. And then we also have the same thing with a high boy chest, which I'm sure, you know, if you've ever been to High Point or if you come to High Point, we have one of the largest chests of drawers that is downtown, and it is just it's a office building, but it looks like a piece of furniture. So that's really cool. And so we have one of those in our museum, and that shows how it's actually made and how that if you put a different hardware on it, such as, you know, the handles and the different pieces of brass, how it makes it look different depending on your style and what fits in with your home.
Okay, so now moving on to the miniatures. What can you tell us about the art of miniatures just in general? What's the process that goes into it?
Oh, it's very detailed and very intricate. And what our miniatures here, the donor that gave ours to us, she likes to make sure that you realize that a miniature is a piece of art. It is not meant to be played with. It is meant to be looked at and admired. And what it is they replicate it. She has in our rooms, we have pieces that actually represent actual homes and rooms from different things in her life. We also have pieces that, you know, she just, her fantasies, you know, so you can represent anything, and it's a way to showcase everything that you love in your community. And that's what she did. She started these off making them with her grandchildren as a dollhouse, and so that they could actually play and work together and get to know each other a little bit better. And then she just fell in love with the art of miniatures. And so she kept on producing them for several years, and then when she was no longer able to do it and didn't want to get rid of them, she donated her 30 beautiful rooms to the High Point Museum.
Wow. That must have been difficult for her grandchildren to go from being able to play with their grandmother's dollhouses to, no, you can't touch those anymore.
Yeah, probably. But they are works of art. You go in there and you can just, like, you can picture yourself in different parts. You know, there's a room about art in New York, so she's got replica pieces of some, you know, famous artwork on the walls. And then we've got a Christmas room, and then we've got from Old Salem, which is another room here in in North Carolina. So we have, and then she's got just one that is dedicated to one of the rooms in the home where she grew up here in High Point.
And just how small are these miniature rooms?
1 foot in the real world equals 1 inch.
Okay.
So if you were 5 feet tall, that means you would be 5 inches tall in the miniature world. Does
oh,
that make
cool.
sense?
Yeah, yeah. And it sounds like a very labor-intensive process. How long would it take her typically to make one of these miniature rooms and some of the miniature furniture?
Well, it would take her anywhere from 3 to 6 months, depending on how intricate she really and detailed she got in there. And some of the rooms, they're not just straight on looking at a room. You also have to look to the left and right because she added dimension to her room. So you can see out the windows and you might see a garden or the skyline or children playing or that sort of thing. Or like off to the kitchen, you see that she's got one room that's a kitchen, but then off to the side, you can see the pantry. So you see the cans and vegetables and things lining in the kitchen pantry. So they're all unique and they're all very fun to look at. And every time I look at a room, and they've been in the museum about 8 years now, and every time I see something new.
That is so fascinating. So talking a little bit about some of the other parts of the museum now, we noticed on your website that the famous jazz musician John Coltrane actually grew up in High Point. What can you tell us about him and how the city of High Point may have influenced his music career?
Well, his family was very instrumental in his love of music, and he was involved very much in a local church here in town with his grandfather being a minister, and so he actually learned and sang and everything. He was there right when the gospel music is something that would have been a very big contributor to his talent and to his love of music. And so, but we're lucky to have, we actually have his childhood piano here. And what he, you know, he's known for playing the sax, which he did, but he learned on the piano, like so many people. And so he, would actually compose songs on the piano before he would actually play them on the sax, is what we've been told. And so we have on, the piano, he's got some notations on the keys saying it's stuck or it's flat or, you know, this or that. Mm. So we have to protect that. And so the keys, sometimes it's open, sometimes it's closed to protect that. But we also have on display a report he did when he was in the fourth grade and talking about some of the influential people in his life, not only locally, but also some famous people were in there at that time. And so he lived and graduated from school here, and then soon after he graduated, he did move, and that's when he became really famous. But we love to say that he learned to play his music here.
That was the high point of his career, you could say.
Exactly.
So describe a little bit more some of the historic structures that the museum owns. Are there any interesting stories you can tell us about any of them?
Well, we have 4 historic buildings on site, and one of them is the John Haley House. It was built in 1786. It's a brick home. He was actually on the earliest map of this area in North Carolina. His home was listed as a landmark, so that just goes to show how important he was. But he also served as the local blacksmith, and he was a sheriff during his time here. And so that home, like I said, was built in 1786. It's on its original foundation, meaning it has never moved. And so it is the oldest home in Guilford County, and we're very proud that today we have that, and we can use that to show what it would have been like to live in the late 1780s and up until, early 1800s. So we're happy to have that home. And that is a home that when we go in there, you can't touch things. That means everything is original pieces, not to John Haley, but to the time period. And so we try to showcase what it would have been like to have such a home. Then we have a log cabin that was built in about 1801. It was moved to our property in the early 70s, and we use that as a learning room. And what we do with that is everything in that is reproduction, so you can touch it. So we actually have demonstrations such as open hearth cooking, laundry demonstrations, learning about the different types of clothing that people wore and how many types of clothes they wore all at once,
sure.
Not like we do today. And then so people can actually touch and feel and understand what it was like to be live during that time period. And then we also have a blacksmith shop on site. As I said, John Haley was a blacksmith, so we're trying to interpret that. And the blacksmith shop was built in about 1841, and it was moved to our property in the 1970s as well. And We have a blacksmith that comes out here at least twice a month and does actual demonstrations still in that. So it has a working forge, and, you know, he's great with the kids and families, and people come out here and can watch him, you know, make nails and other iron pieces and, you know, just learn everything, what it was like to actually live during that time period. And then the fourth home that or building that we have on our property is the Little Red Schoolhouse, and we're in the process right now of actually renovating and restoring that building. It was built in about 1930 by a local architect here, and it was used as a one-room classroom, and so mostly for kindergarten and first grade classes. It was like an annex to one of our local elementary schools, and it was moved over to our property several years ago. And we're going to, when we reopen it, and we love to call it just by its affectionate name is Little Red. And when we reopen it, we're going to be using it for interpretation of what classes would have been like. And so we've got a whole curriculum based on, like, A is for artifact is what we call it. So A is for artifact. F is for furniture, and H is for hosiery.
I think High Point is a little easier to remember than that.
Yeah.
So what sort of events does the museum host throughout the year?
Well, we do all sorts of things. We bring in guest lecturers to talk about history, of course, on different time periods, and to go along with a lot of our changing exhibit that we're going to be coming. We're actually going to be putting up an exhibit on World War I in the next few weeks, and that'll be up for several weeks. And so we'll have a speaker coming in here and talking about that, because this is the 100th anniversary of the end of World War I, and so we're celebrating that along with the state of North Carolina. But we do other things. We do a family game night. We participate in National Night Out. We do a movie night. We just try to get people into the museum and get excited about learning about their history. We, of course, do school tours and senior adult tours and whatever we can get to get people in the door. That's what we try to do.
Awesome. And Teresa, just in closing, what is it that you hope visitors of the High Point Museum will take away from this experience?
We really just want people to come in and be immersed in the city of High Point and be immersed in our history, in our heritage, and what makes High Point so special.
Teresa, thank you so much for your time. Her name is Teresa Laughlin, and she is the Community Relations Director of the High Point Museum, the furniture capital of the world, and the home of jazz musician John Coltrane, as well as some very fascinating miniature furniture. And now a collection that'll get your taste buds going. It's time for Special Confections.
My name's Dave Wagers, and I'm the candy man. So that's what I get to put on my card, which is a great option. Actually, I'm president of the company, but it's a lot more fun to be candy man than president.
The Idaho Candy Company has been located in the same building in Boise, Idaho for a long time. A little bit longer than it's been in Dave Wager's family.
My dad bought the company in 1984, so my family's had it about 34 years. And he was the candy man before me. So the factory we're in right now, we've been in since 1909. So that's why you see all hardwood floors and high wood ceilings and old wood beams. And you'll see some old equipment as we go through. A lot of it's still operating like it would have in the 20s and 30s and 40s, so it's really a cool old place.
You may know the Idaho Candy Company by its most popular candy bar, the Idaho Spud.
I call the Spud Bar a love-hate bar. People either love it or they hate it, and it has to do with coconut and marshmallow. They can be very divisive ingredients.
It's a chocolate and coconut-dipped marshmallow. But the marshmallow isn't ordinary.
So instead of being made with gelatin, which most like campfire marshmallows are made with, and they're stretchy and pulley, our marshmallow is made with a substance called agar agar. It's so good you have to name it twice, but it's A-G-A-R. And agar is made from seaweed. So it's a very different ingredient. It's actually our most expensive ingredient. So a barrel of agar, it's the size of a barrel, so it weighs about 110 pounds. Well, that 110 pounds... and I get 12 of them on a pallet, that's about $17,000. I'm pretty sure the Spud Bar started in the early teens, so like 1912, 1913 is my guess. So the Idaho Spud Bar was originally built as a healthful candy bar, and you can see that on our old truck pictures. It says Idaho Spud, the healthful candy bar.
Except that the Idaho Candy Company doesn't go around claiming that the Spud Bar is a healthful snack anymore. They like to keep things simple.
We basically make four different candy bars. So the Idaho Spud is the oldest and by far our most popular. So we do about 2 million Idaho Spud bars a year. We probably make 30,000 a day when we're making them. And they're sold in stores in the West, but then we also ship internet orders, and, you know, and they're sold all over the country that way. And then we have the Old Faithful and the Cherry Cocktail, and then we a newer one is the Huckleberry Jim, which has only been around maybe 5 or 6 years.
And like the Idaho Spud Bar, things haven't changed too much for the other candies made by the Idaho Candy Company.
Well, some of it's still done a lot the same. So, I mean, we're still buying sugar from the same company. We still use some of the same equipment. And so it's really fun to see, and a lot of the same products. I mean, we have old products.
The Idaho Candy Company is one of the few really successful small candy businesses in continuous operation in the U.S.
In the big scheme of things, we are not a big sugar user. We go through about 10,000 pounds a week.
But despite their small size, Dave Wagers feels optimistic about the company's future.
So I view candy as kind of a reverse economic indicator in some ways. It never gets bad. So even when things are bad, the economy's bad, you may not buy a car, you may not buy a new refrigerator, but you'll still buy a candy bar.
We're diving into the world of hand sanitation. With everyone and their neighbor trying to ward off colds, what better time to interview John French, the founder and curator of the Moist Towelette Museum in East Lansing, Michigan. John, welcome to Special Collections.
Thanks, Jeff. Glad to be here.
Tell us about the founding of this museum and what was the Moist Towelette that made you decide to start collecting them?
I don't know if it was any one particular Moist Towelette that started it, but it kind of evolved from kind of a joke. I mean, I'll tell you, I work at a planetarium, and I was working in a planetarium in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the Buell Planetarium, and the internet was pretty new back then. It was, you know, in the late 90s, and we were just amazed that you could. Well, you didn't Google stuff back then. I guess we Alta Vista'd or something like that. And you could type in almost any kind of word, and, you know, you'd get some kind of, you know, weird collection. And then at the same time, we used to have kind of a running joke when we, you know, maybe work on a planetarium show production, and my coworker was, "Oh, that's such a good show. I need to have a Moist Towelette." So we would joke about that. So I typed in the word moist into the search engine to see if I could, you know, find some stuff about that. And I didn't find any Moist Towelette collections. Not a lot of other things related to moist, like, you know, moist brownie recipe and moisture stuff and things like that. But I said, I'm going to be the first person to put a Moist Towelette webpage up. So I started collecting Moist Towelettes, and it took me a few years before I actually got the website set up. Then I had noticed by then, I think there were a few other Moist Towelette websites, but.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I don't know if they're still around. That was back in the days of GeoCity. Do you remember GeoCity? That was a popular website. And so it was on, you know, one of those sites. And then I guess it really kind of evolved into the museum when, I was down in working in a planetarium in Texas by that time in Corsicana, Texas. And a lot of my colleagues knew that I collected Moist Towelettes and would send them to me. And I was hosting a conference, and just kind of as a bit of a joke, we had a display case that had a Mars rover display in it. And I took that Mars rover display out, and I put all my Moist Towelettes in the display case and made a little sign that said Moist Towelette Museum, and just thought I'd, you know, get a bit of a joke when, you know, my colleagues came to town and saw the Moist Towelettes on display.
Sure.
And, you know, they laughed. That was funny. And then, you know, being lazy, it took me a while to put the Mars rover back. And I noticed that the visitors to the museum had a lot more. They spent a lot more time looking at the Moist Towelette collection than they ever did the little Mars rover exhibit that we had. That might be onto something here.
Yeah.
So I've kind of kept it up, and then, you know, eventually I moved to East Lansing and put the display in my office, and it's been picked up by, you know, internet and news media and stuff over the years, and then people will, you know, hear about it, you know, one way or another, and stop by and check it out. And people keep donating more Moist Towelettes to me, and it's really been a lot of fun.
Yeah. So how many of these moist towelettes do you have, and how do you decide which ones make the collection and which ones just get tossed into the trash?
Well, I don't really toss anything into the trash, but if I have a duplicate of something, it usually goes in kind of a separate bin. But, you know, if it's something that I don't have, I usually try to put it in the display. It's kind of overflowing with moist towelettes. It's a pretty small display that's in there. It just takes up, you know, a small corner of my office. But there's, I haven't counted them, but there's got to be, you know, over 1,000 of them.
Wow. So what would you say are some of the highlights of your collection? What are some of your favorites?
Yeah, well, you know, I kind of have them categorized into different shelves. There's one section that is a lot of the international moist towelettes. There's another section that is some of the, you know, just standard restaurant type towelettes. And then we have, you know, some of the technical kind of wipes for, you know, maybe a moist towelette for cleaning your eyeglasses or something like that.
Sure.
But within that, I have one. It's a pretty old looking one. It's from the Russian railways.
Hmm.
And I guess on the Russian railway, they gave out moist towelettes, and someone at some point gave me one of them. That's an interesting one. I have Hard Rock Cafe from Beijing and Kuala Lumpur.
Hey, I've been to the one in Beijing.
Good. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I have one of their moist towelettes on display. And then what's another good one? There was another friend of mine was in Japan and went to a sumo wrestling match, and they give you the little box lunch, a bento box, I guess they call it, a little box lunch while you're watching the thing. And then inside there was a moist towelette that has a little drawing of some sumo wrestlers on it.
Oh, cool.
that's a fun one. Like over on the technical side, I have one that is called a radical wash for wiping away radioactive contamination.
Hmm.
And I don't know what makes it any different than a moist towelette, but and it's not a used one, so I think we're safe there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us about, I understand that you have a celebrity wing of your collection. What can you tell us about that?
Right. It's a pretty small wing, but the celebrity wing of the moist towelette collection is my only used moist towelette. I have a moist towelette that was used by Tom and Ray Malyatsi, the Car Talk guys.
Really?
Yeah. And it's a Gojo hand wipe for cleaning dirt and oil off your hand after working on a car.
Yeah.
And it's signed and says, first used by Tom, then by Ray.
Do you happen to know how old the moist towelette industry is, John?
The oldest one that I have that has a confirmed date on it is from 1963. It's, I believe, a wash-up towelette. And wash-up, I think, was the name of it. And that was from 63, which really kind of surprised me. I didn't realize that they, you know, went back that far. But my suspicion is probably in the 60s is when they were first invented and packaged and sold as individual wipes.
So how many people would you say visit you each year in your office to check out the moist towelettes?
Yeah, well, it's really kind of expanded, you know, traffic-wise quite a bit in the last few years. It's probably every month there's probably three or four parties that kind of come walking in that are just there to see the Moist Towelette Museum. And then they, you know, usually if I have time, I like to take them into the planetarium and show them around and show them some of the other stuff we do.
Sure.
But the, and during the summertime, I, of course, that's when people are traveling. You tend to get a lot more visitors. I had a couple that came last summer, and they were doing a cross-country tour and visiting unique and interesting places. So they, you know, had the Moist Towelette Museum on their list of places to go. But I think after me or before that, they were planning to go to Iowa to visit the future birthplace of James T. Kirk.
What sort of reactions do you get from people that do come and see the Moist Towelettes?
Oh, they're usually very, very pleased and very happy and just astonished that such a thing exists. And, you know, get a lot of smiles. And that's really what I'm trying to go for. If I can make people happy and put a smile on their face, I feel I've done my job for the day.
You mentioned that you have collected over 1,000 moist towelettes. Is there any part of the world that from which you haven't collected a moist towelette yet?
I've often commented that I have them from, I think, every continent except for Antarctica. And
oh my
goodness. That would be one that would be really good if some polar explorer ever brings me a moist towelette from down there. That would be a lot of fun.
Just in closing, John, if we come across any interesting moist towelettes, I suppose we can look you up and send them your way.
Yeah. So if you find a moist towelette that you think is museum worthy, you can send it my way. The address is on the website, and I can give it to you. But it's interesting. Another kind of humorous anecdote is that I did have the mailing address on the website as my home address, and then Google and its infinite wisdom decided to tag that on Google Maps. So if you would zoom in on Google Maps and look for Moist Towelette Museum, it would send you to my house instead of my office. And I said, well, I don't want people showing up at my house looking for the Moist Towelette Museum. It's not here. So I did have to kind of go in and change the address on the website to reflect the true location of the Moist Towelette Museum.
Yeah.
But then I noticed as you zoom in on the Abrams Planetarium where I work, the label says Moist Towelette Museum before it says Abrams Planetarium.
Ah,
so
wow.
Bigger
than the planetarium.
Yeah, somebody at the university might not like that. But
Today on Special Collections, we've proved that great things can and often do come in small packages. And if you need more proof, as we wrap up the show, let me share with you just a small list of record holders. I couldn't end the show without another pun. Excuse me. The smallest independent country is the Vatican City, of course, an enclave within the city of Rome in Italy. It has an area of 0.17 square miles and is smaller than the Pentagon. The smallest woman ever was Pauline Musters, known as Princess Pauline. A post-mortem examination revealed her height to be 2 feet. The smallest man, on the other hand, was Chandra Bahadur Dangi. He was 21.5 inches tall. The world record for the smallest cat is held by a kitty named Tinker Toy, a male Blue Point Himalayan Persian. He measured 7.5 inches long when he was fully grown. James Madison was the smallest U.S. president, measuring at 5 feet 4 inches. The shortest NBA player was Muggsy Bogues, who is 5 feet 3 inches. And that short stature didn't keep him out of the movie Space Jam. You'll notice him there. And to finish off, the shortest war in history, well, that was the Anglo-Zanzibar War. It was a military conflict fought between the United Kingdom and the Zanzibar Sultanate on the 27th of August, 1896. The conflict lasted between 38 and 45 minutes. And that's going to do it for today's episode of Special Collections. I'm your host, Jeff Simpson.
John French.
Hi, John. This is Jeff Simpson. Oh, you
tricked me. Record your message after the tone.
Cole Wissinger produced the program.
I hope that he can shorten this winter for us a little bit.
With help from Sage Smiley.
Oh, she's just a novice, doesn't know what she's quite up to.
Gracia Lee and Becca Hurley.
That's kind of the short history of it.
You can hear today's episode and all past episodes on BYURadio.org, the BYU app, or wherever podcasts are found. Oh, and be sure to follow us on Twitter at BYU Radio.
It is quite a popular thing for women who have extra means.
Special Collections is a production of BYU Radio.
All right, sounds great.